Hi, everybody. Cardinal Timothy Dolan here. Thanks for joining Conversations with the Cardinal on the Catholic Satellite Radio. We're glad you're here. I think you got the tone of the show today. I just had the remarkable experience of 5 days in Kurdistan, in Iraq, with Catholic Near East Welfare Association, visiting the tens and tens of thousands of internally displaced people who have been driven by radical fundamentalists from their homes and have sought sanctuary in Kurdistan, and who have been welcomed with remarkable warmth and effectiveness by the tiny Christian community there. I wasn't alone. You just heard Bishop William Murphy, the Bishop of Rockville Center, who was with me. And I got two other guests who not only survived but prospered through this with me. You all know, I think, of Monsignor Kevin Sullivan, who's the Executive Director of Catholic Charities here in the Archdiocese of New York. Monsignor's got his own show on Catholic Satellite Radio. A little higher ratings than mine, I understand. Tom Gallagher, folks, we became good friends. There's no better way to get to know people than traveling, right, Tom? And
that's correct.
Tom was one of the excellent journalists that was with us that were able to document it. I hope Tom's going to tell you how you might be able to access some of the photographs. But, Monsignor, you and I have talked about it forever already. You probably just were eavesdropping on my conversation with Bishop Murphy. It sounds like a cliche, but we left remarkably exuberant and inspired, even though it was a very somber situation that we were in. How do you process that?
Well, again, not exactly the same analogy, but weeds and wheat. In most situations, as we journey to God's kingdom, there is things that are terribly wrong about a situation, and yet, in the midst of what's wrong, there's a tremendous amount of good, too. That's precisely what this situation. No way should these people have been thrown out of their homeland. No way should these tens of thousands have had to flee, subjected to the persecution. And yet, the resiliency of the human spirit, God's grace, and that welcoming of that Christian community there meant it was a situation in which there was at least a certain amount of human dignity.
Mm-hmm. Tom, have you ever been Tom Gallagher with us, along with Monsignor Sullivan? I'm Cardinal Dolan. Thanks for being on Conversations with the Cardinal. Tom, have you ever been on a visit like this? You're a journalist. You've been around the world. Have you ever visited people, displaced people, or people in refugee camps?
I have not. I've been to Cairo. I've been outside of Cairo in the past, but this was a first. And it was very, very moving, as you outlined and Bishop Murphy outlined. One of the highlights for me was to see Kineoa in action, mm-hmm. and their work setting up healthcare clinics that, as you saw, were filled to the brim, mm-hmm. from the elderly to the young people to the newborns. So that was very inspiring. I think the work of the Dominican Sisters is second to none. Yeah. I think they're like the glue that keeps that community organized.
Wow. Yeah, I'm with you there. What got me, and Bishop Murphy mentioned it, were the sisters and priests that accompanied the
Correct.
People. Now, in fact, Monsignor Sullivan and I spoke to the Catholic Charities Board yesterday. A lot of the people caring for them, so the Christian community in Kurdistan has set up an infrastructure, and they've got a lot of people working. But a lot of the people working, the teachers, the nurses, the physicians, are themselves internally displaced people who are part of the community that's
right.
displaced.
That's right.
You saw that, didn't you?
And one of the most important parts of that story is that the folks coming from Karakosh, the largest Christian city, from Mosul and all the villages, they speak Arabic. And in Kurdistan, they speak Kurdish mm-hmm. language. And so you can't, you know, there's a language barrier. So it was so important that these displaced adults, doctors, teachers, aides, took on responsibility firsthand,
yeah,
and we saw it.
You met Monsignor Tom mentioned the Catholic Near East Welfare Association, and Monsignor John Kozar, who directs that splendid organization, was supposed to be with us, but he's lost his voice. Monsignor, but we saw two other groups and agencies that have come to the rescue. Which one stood out in your mind?
Well, what stood out in the mind to me is that people were working together, and again, that's a particular function that Catholic Near East Welfare Association has, is to make sure that all the groups doing the work are working together and they're working across purposes. So there were organizations, I think Christians of the East were there, Misericordia, a lot of the European nations were there. I think there were some Italian mm-hmm. aid organizations that were there. Obviously, in a little bit different place than we were, Catholic Relief Services were there. So mm-hmm. there really has been a tremendous
aid to the church in need.
Right.
Knights of Columbus.
The Order
Tom,
of Malta.
Tom, you were, I was going to ask you, because you're a member of the Order of Malta, you were impressed with them. But you're right about everybody working together, and we don't want to shortchange the government. I mean, we kind of think of the governments here as corrupt and failing to protect their people, and Lord knows there's enough of that. But in Kurdistan, anyway, the Kurdistan government had been of great assistance to those people, right?
That's right. And plus, the federal government in Baghdad, along with the Kurdistan regional government, had been supplying different aid services and funds to build these camps. You know, one of the issues we noticed, we were briefed by one of the camp directors, is the camps are filling up. And then they have new marriages, and they have new kids. And so they've got challenges.
We saw some, didn't we?
We saw a lot. And I think one of the highlights of the trip is the fact that it was a pastoral trip. And I think you really, you know, hit it out of the park in terms of being a real presence of the church to these suffering people.
Yeah. Monsignor, you talk a little bit about the faith there. I mean, if anybody had the right to be angry at God, if anybody had the right to have their faith dashed, and yet we saw the opposite. The masses that we had were jammed, and the reverence and the joy and the vitality of the people. Just to know that these people had left home and left people that they loved to preserve their faith. That we saw the depth of the faith, right?
Well, it was there. One of the examples was kind of in the middle of the day. I think there were over 400 kids preparing for their first communion.
Oh, remember? Yeah.
It was just a remarkable thing. The two masses that we were at, which had choirs, the choirs who were singing there were as good as any choir that we kind of experience here, and maybe better than others. And I do think the point, which I think kind of came up with Bishop Murphy, is that the sisters and the priests came with them, and they shared the same fate. I mean, one of those tragic situations was, I think the numbers are, there were 75 sisters who kind of picked up overnight and left to go to their new home, and some of them had to sleep outside in these same caravans. And I think within the course of a year, 24 of the 75 died.
Had died because some of the elder sisters the exposure to the elements and all had their faith had deteriorated. Yet the vocations are strong, right? And even the seminarians that we saw, Tom.
That's right. One story that I wrote about that was very moving was in early August of 2014 when everyone left Karakosh and got to Ankawa outside of Erbil. The Dominican sisters were looking for altar cloth to say an outdoor mass, to have an outdoor mass, and they couldn't find one. And so one of the Dominican sisters took off her scapular and laid it on the ground. And they put the chalice on the ground, and the priest was able to say mass for 200 people.
Yeah. These were, and this sense of Monsignor John Kozar, I wish he could be with us, had he not laryngitis, he uses that word accompaniment, that Kanewa's charism is to accompany. They don't parachute outside help in. They give help to the people that we know and work with on the ground they're best able to care for their people. Sense of accompaniment, we tried to do it in Catholic Charities as well, Monsignor, but that was so evident there, wasn't it?
Absolutely. And again, as you say, Catholic Near East Welfare Association, Catholic Charities, Catholic Relief Services, what is so valuable, especially when there's an emergency and a crisis, is that we've been there.
You got it.
Before.
Yeah.
And so it's not like, hurry up and get ready. Yes, there's a crisis, you got to do more. But we're already working with people. There are relationships. And as you've often said, as you go through those camps, the priests, the nuns, the professionals, they knew those people by name.
Yeah. And this time, weren't you, mate, with the, remember the story about the priest at the one camp that we were at? And the people told us on their priest that he had come with them,
That's right.
So when he arrived at the camp, before the caravans were set up that Bishop Murphy described, these temporary housings, of course, the people had to sleep outside, either under the stars or some of them in tents. And the priest, of course, the brother priest in the area said, Father, come on, you can stay at the rectory. He said, no, I must stay here and sleep here in company with my people until they're taken care of, until they have a roof over their head. That's the kind of just being with the people that so lifted us up. No?
Yeah, no question about it. And one of the things that was really surprising in a very positive way is these priests and nuns, many of them are highly educated.
Yeah.
They're academics.
Yeah.
And so part of their day, they're on the front lines caring for the displaced people in the camps or in the churches, in the health centers. And balance of the day, they're in the seminary teaching.
Well, we got, remember the one, and the first place we went to was the Dominican Sisters ran that magnificent school. Wow, right. That could match any grade school that we'd have in New York as far as the ardor, the discipline, the joy of the students,
right.
The dedication of the staff. The sisters were there, and there was the one young sister that was getting all the children ready to receive us and sing for us. And then later when we visited the seminary, we find out that she has her PhD from Notre Dame in biblical studies, and she's a professor at the Babel College in philosophy and theology.
Now, one important distinction, I spoke to her later, her name is Sister Luma, and Sister Luma pointed out to me, out of your earshot, that the year she got her PhD, you received your honorary degree from Notre Dame.
At Notre Dame. She told me that later, too. Bishop Sullivan, you mentioned the bishops. Now, there's a wide array of bishops because you have the Chaldean Catholics, you have the Assyrian Catholics.
Please
and you
don't
get
give
the Orthodox.
Me a quiz.
I wouldn't know the vocabulary to quiz you. But they seemed remarkably savvy and close to the people, too, didn't they?
I was particularly impressed by the Archbishop of Erbil.
Oh, yeah, Archbishop Wardo.
I mean, he really saw both a crisis and an opportunity to be a welcoming church.
Yeah.
And to realize that as the people came there, you know, you don't only need goodwill, you need actual institutions that can welcome and can provide for the people who are there. And he was busy about setting them up.
And we didn't sense, did you, Tom, any panic? They could be very frantic with the challenges they had, but they seemed to do it rather serenely and confidently.
That really stood out. It's as if they took on the worst of the ISIS assault on their living conditions in Karakosh and the villages. They left everything behind under short order, and then quickly, within 14, 15 months, stood up, you know, camps, churches, clinics, schools, a community college, possibility of a regular four-year college. So they've gotten to work taking mm-hmm. care of the people.
I'm going to ask you both about the future. I'm Cardinal Dolan. We got Monsignor Sullivan and Tom Gallagher with us here on the Catholic Channel and SiriusXM Radio. Monsignor, what about the future? As you left, like, what were you thinking? If we went back a year from now, what would you hope to see? I mean, we'd all hope to see that people were able to return home and get resettled. But let's say things politically remain the same. If we went back next year, which who knows, we just may, what is you think to head in the future? What would you hope to see?
I think what you just said is a critical question. There's going to come a point where people are going to realize they may not be able to go home.
Mm-hmm.
And in every immigrant group, in my experience, the beginning is they always want to go home. And then the question is, well, maybe I can't, so can we make a new home here? And again, to give the listeners, viewers, some sense of the ideas, this is a small area. I mean, we're in the New York area. You know, where they were pushed out of was closer than Newburgh.
Sure.
So
right.
it's, and we know in the New York area, the padded. So I would, if I went back a year from now, I would expect to see a little bit more realism as to, are they going to be able to go back, or do they have to make this their new home, and to see how that is playing
and
out.
And didn't you find, Monsignor Sullivan, that the bishops were already anticipating some of that and were telling us about plans? Once the people make the free but painful but necessary decision that maybe we're not going to be able to get back home, we want to get settled here, they're ready to help them.
Yes.
Aren't they? With housing, education.
Yeah, I mean, they were talking about, I mean, which you have been kind of one of the leaders in New York in saying the church should be involved in housing. The bishop there is ready to kind of try to put up 1,000 units of housing there.
Yeah. Tom, what will you, future-wise, if we went back in a year, what would you hope to see?
Well, I think that's the big issue. Will they transition out of the camps and into the local community of Ankawa, which is a Christian community outside of Erbil? So we know that ISIS tends to leave booby traps behind when they're chased out of a community. We know that the U.S. Secretary of Defense is in Iraq today contemplating a move on Mosul to take that back. So even if some of these towns are taken back, they may not be able to go back. And so hopefully they'll be able to move away out of the camps and start developing a community life in Ankawa.
Mm-hmm. Monsignor Sullivan, what, again, we were asked constantly, and people like Tom, the journalist, darn it, what can we do? And our listeners now at home listen to us on the on Catholic Satellite Radio and Sirius Radio here, the Catholic Channel. We're talking about our visit to Kurdistan to and those victims of Christian persecution. People are out there saying, but what are we supposed to do? What do you answer?
Well, I think you answered very well. And this was a pastoral visit.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't a political visit. But, you know, one of the things that pastors have to do is listen to what the people were saying.
Mm-hmm.
And while I didn't pick up a whole lot of anger, I picked up a lot of frustration, uncertainty, and what they said a number of times, please, tell your government that we need help.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted us to be advocates. And,
mm-hmm.
You know, we're not going to get into the politics there, but they kind of think they need help in clearing out ISIS from their homes so mm-hmm. that they can go back. So it's a difficult situation because who knows what the right answer is.
But Tom, what would you answer? And perhaps somebody's already said to you, Tom, you were just there. I enjoyed hearing you talking about your visit to the persecuted Christians in Iraq. How can we help? What have you been answering?
Well, you and I discussed this, and one of the things you share with me is the power of prayer.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't underestimate the power of prayer.
Which nobody appreciates more than the persecuted Christians there. They're people of deep prayer. Remember the camp where they said, we get together every evening and pray the rosary.
That's right.
That this will end.
Remember? That's right. So that's critical. So I'd recommend that to the Christian and Catholic community here in the U.S. But also they have real needs. And as much as Catholic Near East Welfare and others are doing, they have other needs. They have additional medicines they need and so on. So organizations like Catholic Near East, they should be supported. You know, in-kind contributions from the big pharma companies as well as donations.
Mm-hmm.
So I would recommend staying close to the agencies that are doing great work
and
on the ground.
And we mentioned, right, Aid to the Church in Need, the Catholic Near East Welfare Association, our own. Catholic Relief Services, Knights of Columbus, Knights of Malta, Caritas, they're all in it big time.
That's right.
I'm going to ask Joe to tell us how, to remind me of how we can check into Kanawha. Tom, tell folks how they can check into some of your, maybe see some of the visual stuff that you were able to take.
So I attended the trip as a journalist for the National Catholic Reporter.
Mm-hmm.
That's ncronline.org. And I also post at the Huffington Post.
Mm-hmm.
So both outlets.
So they could access and see some of the photographs that you took on the journey.
That's right.
Way to go. And Joe, how can we get, what's the best way to get to Kanawha?
Kanawha.org.
Kanawha.org. Way to go, folks. Told you you'd enjoy it. We got more to come, okay? So don't leave yet. This is Cardinal Timothy Dolan. I've been with Monsignor Sullivan and Tom Gallagher, a journalist. And I hope you can see our exuberance and passion in trying to hope that you will appreciate and understand a bit better the situation in Kurdistan. We just came back from there visiting some of our persecuted Christians under the sponsorship of Kanawha, Catholic Near East Welfare Association. Stay right there. I'll see you in 2 minutes.